Ambassador to the United Nations for many, many years, Managing Director of Iran News Agency, and also Deputy Head for Iran Broadcasting. Excellency, I would like to say a few words about this institute. This institute, the Pakistan Institute of International Affairs, is the oldest think tank in Pakistan. It was established in 1947. But its roots go back in time. It used to be the Indian Institute of International Affairs in Delhi, and it migrated by a majority vote of its members. Came with all the assets of the Indian Institute to Karachi. Our first offices were in Fairmont Gardens, in rented premises. And then the founders of this institute acquired this piece of land, gave this building, it's no building. We have certain distinctions in the way in which we have functioned. That is that we have never taken any aid from any foreign donor. You will understand that most of the think tanks in Pakistan, even the academic institutions are donor-funded, but we have never taken any funds from any foreign donor. So all our work and all our research is in India. Your Excellency, I'd be very grateful if you would make a short statement and then we can open the floor for questions and answers.
Before the Islamic revolution of Iran, the of Iran to Pakistan. And due to religious commonalities, cultural commonalities, and being good neighbors, Alhamdulillah, this has been a food between Pakistani and Iranian population. But in terms of governmental relations, there has been ups and downs. Sometimes we have had very good relations, sometimes the relations are fine. There are a lot of capacities here in Pakistan, or capacities in Iran, which can be awarded to the others. One of the reasons of my visit, as I said, is to see what are the impediments and obstacles and barriers and how these barriers can be removed. In cultural terms, there has been a very good relation between Iran and Pakistan, and remains this cultural cooperation between the two. Anyway, by this short statement, I believe we can hear the views of the audience and wherever it was necessary, I will react.
Who would like to start the discussion? His Excellency will is very keen to hear our views about the relationship between Iran and Pakistan. But I would also be interested, Excellency, in your views about the security situation in our region.
Thank you, Dr. Kamal Khawazi. It was very nice listening to you. I've heard you many times, both in Pakistan as well as in Tehran. It's really a pleasure to see you again here, and also a great pleasure to hear what you have to say. I've been a student of history and also keep a very close eye on Iran-Pakistan relations. This can be divided into many segments, phases.
Relations with Iranian banks, with the excuse that American administration would put sanction on them and punish them, while many other countries are working with Iranian banks, that this has not happened here in Pakistan. It is very strange. Of course, with recent developments, there have been talks between the Iranian side and Pakistan side to nominate a small bank that doesn't have relations with the American banks to restore this kind of relation with Iran. That is one of the problems. The other problem is political will at the Pakistani side. America has had a lot of influence here in this country. As well, some countries of southern Persian Gulf, like Saudi Arabia and Iraq, are immigrants. Unfortunately, the government has been observing the interests of those countries against the interests of. I'll tell you one example. During the presidency of Mr. Zardari, a contract was signed between Iran and Pakistan for gas pipeline. We have observed our commitments, and the pipeline is constructed for Pakistani border. It's just a few kilometers away of Pakistani border. But Pakistani government has not done anything and is not because Americans have put pressure on Pakistan to not do business in India. So there are similar examples, which are because of the pressure of America or some other countries to the Pakistani government. In recent months, there has been some signs of change, and we hope in new atmosphere, the decision will be made between the two sides to facilitate trade and business between Iran and Pakistan. Right now, a free trade agreement is under negotiation, and if this will be concluded, so the flow of goods, vegetables, fruits, and other things from both sides will be seen. So we have to be hopeful that with the new policies, there will be great changes between the countries in terms of trade and
Palestinians all over
from the time of history of Islamic revolution. And Palestinians are not Shia, they are Sunnis. They are Muslims. And as you said, Imam Khomeini from the beginning insisted on unity of Muslims, never talked about Shia revolution, never talked about it. What you hear from mass media or the propaganda of some countries that Iran is looking for Shia crescent, this is not realistic, this is not factual. Because, for example, we have supported Palestinians. We have supported Syrians, and the majority of people in Syria are Sunnis. We have supported Iraqis, and Sunnis in Iraq constitute, you know, a big majority of the population. And we have supported Pakistan. So is the criterion is to be and by Israel and occupation. That's why we talk about resistance front. Resistance front is constituted from Syria, Iraq, Lebanon, and Palestine. And we have been supporting and building up Yemen. For example, if we have been in Iraq and Syria to fight against Takfiri groups like Daesh and Nusra, it's because they invited us, the government asked us to go there, because, you know, Damascus and Baghdad was very close to be collapsed in the hands of Daesh. And in fact, Daesh was very close to the border, only 40 kilometers from the border. Therefore, not only for our own security, but for the sake of resistance front, we accepted this invitation and went there and hopefully defeated Daesh. Therefore, this is not intervention. Intervention is when without the agreement of a government, you send your forces and intervene. Or intervene politically in other affairs. But the case of Iran has not been something like that. Any nation around the world who would ask help and assistance from Iran in opposing Israelis, we are ready to help. And this is our policy.
Iran has been under international sanctions. I just want to know how your local people understand that they suffer and they sacrifice, but they stand united against such odds. How is that possible? And number two, apart from foreign policy objectives, which are common to most of the states, that is prosperity and peace and good relations with other countries, what are specific foreign policy approaches for Iran since the last decade? What are specific approaches regarding foreign relations of Iran in the last decade? Last 10 years. Yes. Thank you.
Yes, there has been. Therefore, although most of countries were supporting Iraq against Iran, we managed to win that war. Why? Because people had faith in revolution. People loved their country. Ideologically and patriotically, they loved Iran and they sacrificed to win this war against the enemy. This was a plot against Iran. Qudsa was a plot. All kinds of sanctions has been put against Iran all through this year since revolution. In fact, we are 40 years under sanction by Americans, by others. But in spite of this, people have tolerated these sanctions. Of course, there are voices that maybe are anxious, they are not comfortable with the sanctions, but the majority of people are tolerating this situation for the sake of their country, for the sake of Islamic revolution. So this is a secret. Otherwise, people are not pressurized by the Iranian government to keep silent. No, this is their understanding, this is the face that they have to tolerate this situation. And in fact, sanctions have helped us in certain aspects to work harder and to solve our problems by our wisdom, by our intelligence, and by our scientific development, and many armaments are made in Iran these days. We do not import arms. In science and technology, Iran, you know, has been doing very well. And not only in nuclear energy, but in other science and technologies, you know, in the organics, for example, in nanotechnology, Iran is ahead of many countries. In the medicine, also Iran is doing very well. In pharmaceutical, especially new pharmaceuticals, biotechnological pharmaceuticals, Iran is doing very well. Sanction has helped us. It is true that has been difficult, that people have tolerated that, and we have been able to move under sanction. And in terms of industries, many items are manufactured in Iran. We manufacture each year around 1,500,000 cars in Iran, and some of them are exported to other countries. So this is the fruit of resistance. This is the fruit of independence. And one thing that I want to assure you, that Iranians are not going to miss their independence by pressure, that they become more determined to keep independence and tolerate all different pressures from outside. The second question about the foreign policy of Iran in the last 10 years, there has not been important change in foreign policy of Iran. In last 10 years, compared to years from the revolution up to now, because the foreign policy is led by the leader of Islamic Republic. During the time of Imam Khomeini and the time of now, at the time of Ayatollah Khamenei, all through this year, the foreign policy has been the same. The main pillar of foreign policy is opposing intervention of Americans in our country. The pillar of foreign policy of Iran has been helping and assistance to nations who need help. In terms of resistance against the United States, resistance against Israelis, and resistance against European intervention in internal affairs of Muslim countries. So almost it has been the same. There may be changes, very little bit changes, depending on the situation or the specific country, but the foreign policy has been the same and hopefully will remain the same.
I have to answer again. In your yesterday, we had a lot of discussion along with the journalist. One question actually I want to ask, and I have wanted to give my attention on all the writers who were there yesterday. They are very much concerned about the hardship that they will be down there. They are very much concerned about the hardship that the young people are concerned. The sanctions actually have made Iran people actually welcome, but at the same time, the economic information that you have drawn into the past are from the Iran, they will still suffer. And the recent disturbances, you know, which took place in Iran were basically because of the economic sufferings and because of the economic, you know, hardship they are facing. My question is, if the hardships are there and they have been very tough to face the onslaught of the police forces in the region. But at the same time, do you think that this hardship, you know, the question of crime and the sanctions, you know, which has created a lot of problems for the common man of Iran, will subside because of the production, as you said, the car production and the other production, the armament production? So, what do we see in the future about the condition, the economic development, the economic situation of the people of Iran? Do you think within a very short span of time it will take place, or again it will face the same problems of economic you know, hardship for the people of Iran? And my second brief issue is, how do you think about the nuclear agreement between Iran and the Trump administration? Do you think the Trump has the power to eliminate and to cancel the agreement with you?
This is the promise that we have made on our country to save their revolution, to save their identity, to save their independence. It is all that. We hope that these sanctions will be removed again. Especially we expect friendly countries share with us Islamic values, to business leaders, to develop commercial relations. That certainly would be very valuable, especially neighboring countries. Although we were under heavy sanctions during those days, we had business with neighboring countries, for example, with Turkey, we had a lot of business with Turkey, with Iraq, with Afghanistan, with Pakistan, later. So in neighboring countries, there can be many businesses, even under sanctions. On nuclear deal, we have been committed to this nuclear deal. America has violated the nuclear deal many times. And still we are waiting for them in May to decide that if they are going to stay in this deal or withdraw. Our position is that we are ready for any alternative that we have. If European countries get to stay and meet their commitments, that is one option. If they also withdraw from the deal, that is the reason why Iran should remain. So we are ready for all different options. Whatever happens, we will manage.
Assalamu alaikum. I am a young member at this institute. And that is one thing, I guess, that's very unique about Iran and Pakistan, that we are both Islamic republics. And I guess one thing that can bring us together, you spoke about the barriers between our relationship that maybe we should more reflect on, is a fundamental root that we kind of share, that I know in Iran they appreciate a lot, is Allah Iqbal. And Allah Iqbal, and the majority of his poetry, which is in Farsi. So, speaking about barriers and your concerns, I think a lot of Pakistanis currently have one concern on their mind, that is currently there's a narrative going on that Iran and India are getting close in their relations and this agreement at Chabahar Port. And I think this is one of the main barriers in the mainstream Pakistani community. And where is Iran's standpoint on this? And if there are better relations with Pakistan, then why is India being entertained to a certain degree? And also, if you can add some points, recently you made a comment about this new bilateral agreement or some sort of alliance between Iran, Russia, China, and Pakistan that was also expressed by some Pakistani counterparts. If you could elaborate on that, especially in light of Afghanistan, and what we should do. Thank you.
This is true that we have relations with India as we have relations with Pakistan, we have relations with all nations. And we don't mind that each of these countries have their own relation with others. For example, Pakistan has a relation with the United States. We don't mind. Pakistan has a relation with Saudi Arabia. We don't mind. What we say is that Pakistan should not submit to the pressures of the specific powers and government, who should show its independence in its own national policies. That is what we say. With India, yes, we have relations, but never we have forgot the needs and positions of Muslims in India or Pakistan on the questions like Kashmir and other issues. We have been always talking to Indians that Kashmiri issues has to be tackled peacefully, justly. And even we have suggested to India that we are ready to mediate between Iran, between Pakistan and India. And never they have agreed. I know that Pakistan is ready for mediation, but Indians do not agree. Their presence in Chabahar does not mean that they are going to have a unique and exclusive right here in Chabahar. Chabahar is a platform and is open to anybody who wish to be present there. And that's why we have invited China, we have invited Pakistan, we have invited Oman and others to come along and invest in Chabahar. Chabahar can play a very important role regionally because from Chabahar we are constructing more to Zahedan. We are constructing railway to Zahedan. And from Zahedan to the border of Turkmenistan. So the south-north corridor is under construction. Also there are east-west corridors available. And we have suggested to Chinese and to Pakistanis if their port, which is under construction, would be connected to Chabahar. Then Silk Road, which ends to other port, can continue to use Iranian corridor to the west, to the east, to the north, and therefore have access to Central Asia, to Caucasus, to Middle East, to Europe, to Russia, and that completes the Silk Road. Therefore, it's open. It's a platform open to any nation who would like to invest in Chabahar and use these facilities for its own purpose. So it's not exclusively in service to India. Thank you.
Your Excellency, I would like to ask about how Iran sees democratic continuity in Pakistan. Is it in its favor, or it has been easier to deal with the dictators about, as compared to the democratic governments? Because 2018 is the year of elections in Pakistan. So how would you like to comment on that, considering that we have had 44 years of martial laws in Pakistan, more than the democratic governments? Thank you.
Can you take another question?
This is a fact that you have powerful parties here, and this is also itself a sign of democracy. Thank you. There has been competition between these parties, and each time one party has won the majority in the parliament, the prime minister has assigned by that party. But there is another fact that the military establishment is very powerful in Pakistan. And that creates a lot of power in Pakistani politics. This is also a fact. And in a fully democratic nation, naturally, politicians have to run the country, and military establishment has to be under the service of politicians who are chosen by the votes of people. Of course, I understand that democracy in certain countries are not easily achieved. This is also, you cannot establish full democracy at one night. It takes time. It takes time, depends on the majority of people. It takes time based on our democratic culture to be a station to take full control of the fate of the nation. So we hope that Pakistani democracy will be led toward that direction to have a full democracy in the country. In Farsi language and speaking between countries have been reduced compared to the past. This is what I agree to. And it's a pity. We have to study that, what are the reasons. One reason is that English language is very popular here, and people are gradually excusing themselves, especially the younger generation, to study Urdu and the basis of Urdu, which is Farsi, because English language is enough for them to just do their job daily. And this is a fact. That by itself has informed us. In the old times in India, and even when Pakistan separated from India, Parsi language was very popular. In old time, Parsi language was the language of the court. And whatever documents you have from those times are in Persian. But this has been changed because of the British colonialism here and the policy to impose English language on people in these territories. Now these days, culture, I mean, Western culture of the fact, because everything is in English. If you want to find articles, mostly are in English. When you want to Google something, everything comes in English. So English has become a dominant language, and that is also one factor which deserves to be studied. But more than that, something which is on our side is less investment from Iranian side on teaching language, I mean Farsi language in other nations. I believe we have to invest more in on Akhan in Barcelona institutions here who teach Farsi to our brothers and sisters in Pakistan, because Farsi is the basis of their national language, supposedly. And due to, I mean, the financial resources or whatever, this is the reality that I can face. But we have to change this. And inshallah, by better relation between Iran and Pakistan, we have to invest more to help Pakistani children, Pakistani young generation, to learn Farsi and become policy makers.
The gentleman asked about RCD.
Visa policies.
RCD.
Visa policy. Right now, more than 200,000 visas are issued each year for Pakistani people who go there to Iran for Ziyara. And for other businesses, for tourism. This is not still enough. I believe this has to be increased, and more facility should be given to brothers and sisters in Pakistan to be able to visit Iran, to go to Ziyara, to go to business, to go for sightseeing. We have many historical sites that may be interested for Pakistanis to see in Isfahan, in Shiraz, in other places. Inshallah, by the development of relations between the countries, this can be
achieved.
Sir,
excuse
me, I would like to make here a comment, Excellency. And that is that although the government does function in English, however, a lot of work is also done in English, especially at the local government level. A great deal of work is done in Urdu, in the universities. A great deal of work is done in Urdu. I was a member, and still am, a member of the Karachi University Syndicate. All its proceedings were done. And I think that there is a certain class of people who are very visible. And therefore, one gets the feeling that English is the dominant language. But actually, the people who really know English are very few in number. And the largest circulation of all newspapers is of Urdu newspapers. English newspapers have a very small circulation. Very small circulation. Before I give the last question to Vajina, I would like to ask a question myself, if I may. And that is how do you see this terrible turmoil that has been going on our borders for a very long time, also reached your borders? And that is, how does one resolve the issue of the turmoil in Afghanistan?
Afghanistan was part of the inclusion of the team. I forgot to answer, but that was the difficulty. Afghanistan is very important as a neighboring country for all of us. For Pakistan, for Iran, for China, for Russia, for Central Asian countries. And all of us are suffering from what is going on in Afghanistan. It is 17 years that Americans are in Afghanistan to defeat Taliban, and they have not succeeded to defeat Taliban. I believe enough is enough. How long they want to stay there, I believe, is the time that changes has to be happening. But I don't think Americans would leave Afghanistan so soon, because strategically, Afghanistan is very important for them. They have mentioned in their recent strategy, security strategy that Iran, Russia, China are considered to be threats, major threats to the United States. And if they remain in Afghanistan, so they can react to these three countries. So they're looking for excuses to stay there. And recently we have heard that even members of Daesh are transferred to Afghanistan, and that's a new danger. Therefore, we support any kind of peace negotiations between the Afghani government and Taliban. And I believe this is the policy of Pakistan as well, to support negotiations. And if any peace could be dealt with between Pakistan, between Afghanistan and Taliban, the situation may change.
Excellency, are you saying that if the Americans withdraw from Afghanistan, then the trouble in Afghanistan will stop?
No, I said that if peace negotiations between Taliban and Afghani government would resolve, then the situation would be prepared for Americans to flee. But from the other hand, what has been the result of Americans' presence in Afghanistan? They have not been able to defeat the Taliban. So we have to look for other ways and means how to solve the problem of Afghanistan. And neighboring countries can have very important role in changing the situation in Afghanistan, in bringing peace in Afghanistan, to pushing Taliban and the government of Afghanistan to make a deal. In that case, then Americans, there is no room for them to stay there.
Wajiha?
Thank you. My question related to Iran's relation with the nation.
Don't worry.
I'll give it to my council member. This afternoon, both questioners and yourself mentioned Daesh in other forms. I'd like to hear the considered views of yourself and your institute. Who is behind Daesh? Who is financing it? And what is the mechanism they have adopted so far that there is no open or there is no proven link between the supporters of Daesh and Daesh itself?
This is the nature of terrorism, that terrorists are supported somehow, that no document is left. But in fact, it is far clear, everyone knows that, even Western countries know that, and they have declared that Saudi Arabia, Qatar, United Arab Emirates have been the main supporters of Daesh and Jihad al-Nusra. Each of them
because Saudi Arabia also.
Pardon?
Daesh has carried out attacks in Saudi Arabia also.
I tell you that Daesh, you know, the ideology of Daesh is actually, they call everyone other than themselves prophet. And they are ready to kill anybody who doesn't believe in their ideology. The basis of this kind of ideology, we believe that Islamism, which has been promoted by Saudi Arabia all through these years. They have trained many imams based on Wahhabism, and have sent them over in different places. Daesh have been recruiting people who have become acquainted with Wahhabism in different parts of the world, even in Europe. And I believe that this has been basically a plot which goes back to American and Israeli policies to create problems among Muslims and put different sides to fight each other. The film has been produced recently by PBS of the United States. PBS is a very popular channel. It's called Bitter Rivalries Saudi Arabia and Iran. Reviews the whole story from the beginning of Islamic revolution. That certain countries like Saudi Arabia were afraid of the influence of the Islamic revolution in the whole region. That is why they supported Saddam Hussein against Iran. That is why they tried to create a new force by preaching Wahhabism and preaching extremism among the young generation. And they found Afghanistan crisis a good place to do that. And this has been continued. And in Syria, we have seen the fruits of this extremism in terms of Daesh. Daesh is a danger to everyone. That's true that you have been, I mean, Daesh even have done some operations in Saudi Arabia, but not that much. Most of operations has been out of Saudi Arabia. In fact, the extremism and factory extremism have been created to counter Islamic revolution of it. And this is exactly what the film says. And says that despite of all of these plots and all these, programs, still the influence of Iran is spreading all over the Middle East, and therefore none of these plots have been, successful in keeping Iran from having more influence in other countries. That is because Iran has been insisting on its independence, has been insisting on implementing Islamic values, and naturally people are attracted to such a system, which is totally based on
Excellency. Thank you so much for honoring us with your presence. Not only have you come yourself, but you have also brought four very distinguished members of the team and delegation, like the respected Master General in Karachi. Our institute has had a relationship with the Institute of International and Political Studies in Tehran. I had the honor of speaking there on two occasions. And we also used to exchange our journal, this journal which I am going to present to you, which we have been publishing since 1948 without the break. We used to exchange it with the Iranian Journal of International Affairs until the English version of the Iranian Journal ceased publication. I have the happiest memories of working with Iranian diplomats when I was ambassador in Vienna, and I was accredited to the United Nations and to the International Atomic Energy Agency. Ambassador Modeshami, I had the pleasure of working with him, and in the International Atomic Energy Agency, I had the pleasure of working very closely with Ambassador Ayatollah. Those were days in which we spent all our time trying to keep Israel out of the Gaza region. And it makes me very happy that Israel still hasn't found a home in any of those regions.
Great success.
Excellency, thank you very much again for coming. I hope that you can, in fact, revive our relationship with these institutions in Tehran and in other parts of Iran. I want to present to you, I won't lift it, but I will leave it here on the table. These are four issues. Last year was our 70th anniversary, and we took out four commemorative issues of our journey. So one set is for you, and one is for Mr. Basudev. Thank you for coming, and I can only repeat that we have been greatly honored, and I hope that you will visit us again.
Thank you very much. It has been my pleasure to be present at this prestigious institute run by Your Excellency, and I hope that this sort of context will be continued for more collaboration, more exchange of views. There may be some differences, but I'm sure that the exchange of views will be very useful.
I would like to invite everybody for a cup of tea.